to you by Penguin.
Chicken Boy, My Life with Hens, written and read by me, Arthur Parkinson. Chicken Boy. You notice other small beings far more when you're little. I am a toddler the first time I meet a chicken, and we are equal in size and height. The hen has tiny eyelashes, a strawberry jam face, and a voice of purring clucks. I sense a happy spirit of inquisitiveness and smiling fascination. From that moment on, I will always love the company of chickens. It's hard to explain completely, other than to say that it is an instant attraction, one owed especially to their movement and energy. I have found my tribe. Every day, I eagerly emptied out the contents of the plastic box where we kept our toy farm animals. Each one, an individual presented by Mum. "What's in my hand?" she would say. I'd tap it and a palm would open to reveal another beautifully painted model hen or cockerel. I created makeshift miniature hen houses and barns from old boxes, their cut-out windows meshed over with bits of netting from bags of onions. Life in our tiny cottage was rich in colour and creativity. There was a tropical fish tank where fantail guppies looked like swirling pieces of silk, and our walls and trunks were covered in decoupages of magazine clippings. Mum planted a tapestry of wallflowers every year in the front flower beds. Everything resembled Persian carpets in one way or another. Hucknall, where I grew up and my family still lives today, is an ex-mining town and the setting of my chicken childhood. My family was made all the bigger by daily interactions with my grandparents. We all lived within minutes of each other. Grandma Sheila and Grandad Ted were on my mum's side. They'd have me and my younger brother Lyndon over after school every Tuesday when Mum worked late, and weekends would often be at Nan or Min's on my dad's side. Sheila was the softie, with huge patience and humour, kind-faced and smiling. They both loved dancing and had countless friends going around the town's Friday market with them meant a long outing with conversations at every turn. She'd let us ride about on the supermarket trolley like a pair of monkeys and adored games. Easter was a time of endless chocolate egg hunts. Ted liked to go fishing, which was just as well because he couldn't cope with Sheila winding up me and Lyndon to the point of craziness. He used to say we were manking about too much. "These pair aren't coming here again." And Sheila would say, "They are." Min was a more stoic character, but had brilliant humour, marching up her much-loved garden with determination and putting us to work with gardening jobs such as hedge cutting, rather than letting us mess about. But she would always have baked that day, and there'd be scones or cobs ready for us afterwards. You'd never phone her during the summer. It was a landline at that time, because she'd be in the garden on her kneeling mat, pulling up ground elder and singing to herself. On her pensioner coach trips, she'd be in something she'd found in the Sally's Army jumble sale that fitted her like a glove, looking glamorous, her big lips smiling and shimmering with lip gloss and her incredible thick head of hair. By the time me and my younger brother Lyndon were born, Nottinghamshire's pits had all shut down, and Hucknall was left with the old slag heap, a man-made hill of black earth and slate-blue shale from when its last pit closed in 1986. It now looked like it was undergoing some sort of giant acupuncture treatment, planted with thousands of saplings with plastic rabbit guards as it was transformed into a park called the Rangers. All around the lower slopes of the Rangers were allotments that backed onto a path known as Black Pad, a muddy dirt track that Mum would take us up most days on the way to nursery, often humming songs from the Jungle Book soundtrack as she pushed my brother along. The path was lined by ancient and characterful hedges, mostly hawthorns twisting and brawling into each other's branches to create a thorny mesh. Holly, ivy and honeysuckle climbed through them too, along with naughty whips of bramble that attacked Lyndon's buggy. Mum always kept a pair of secateurs handy in case of harassment. In some places, the hedges on either side of the path were so tall, they had married, growing into one another to create bowers. Around Easter, when bird song filled the air before the hedge leaves were fully opened, Mum would keep a lookout for birds' nests before they were safely hidden away from prying eyes. She'd lift us up, warning us to be quiet and not to touch so we could see the beautiful cups of mud, moss and twigs that held either speckled eggs or blind little pink chicks of fluff and skin. On one occasion, Lyndon was taken by surprise when a brood of nestlings awoke and started cheeping furiously for food with little wide-open beaks. "Put me down," he said firmly. The most magical time was in May when the hawthorn blossom began to fall like soft snowflakes. By late summer, when all the leaves were fully out, the light became moody, even on a sunny afternoon. Over the years between the hedge trunks, allotment holders had put up sturdy defences against badgers and other intruders, using a curious assortment of cast-offs, mesh fire guards, sheets of rusted corrugated iron, even old bed frames tied together, with odds and sods of wire. This was the boundary for another world and the place where I got to know my first chickens. Grandma Sheila and Grandad Ted knew one of the allotment holders, John, whose plot was behind a large solid turquoise gate. If he was there, the big padlock would be unlocked, allowing the gate to lean open a little. Grandad Ted was a builder, with a particular skill at bricklaying. He could read the condition of a structure in an instant by looking at its bricks. He often worked on demolition jobs, and over the years, salvaged plenty of glass doors and windows that had decent wooden frames. John used some to create a mighty greenhouse. Getting into it was something of a puzzle, because you had no idea which door you were supposed to use, as so many doors also formed the walls of the magical ramshackle glass palace. John used the greenhouse to store smallholding gubbins of all sorts. Rags, carpets, newspapers, among tomato seedlings and chitting potatoes. Completing this perfect picture was a tiny wood-burning stove, a comfy table and chairs, and John's collie dog. John had arrived in England as a refugee after being marched by the Nazis from his native Ukraine to Italy to be used for slave labour. He was 14 when he was taken from his parents, and he would never see them again. It was while he was working on a farm one summer, picking strawberries, that he met Gillian. She took him back to Nottingham at the end of the season. Her parents were furious at her for returning with a tall, tanned, blonde-haired young man, but they married, and John made Hucknall his new home. Keeping watch over John's vegetable beds were scarecrows, each representing one of his grandsons and wearing their old clothes stuffed with straw. For me, though, John's hens were the main attraction. John had a merry flock of laying girls, several dozen of them, living in a big turquoise-painted shed. Around the hen house were old baths to collect rainwater, as the allotments didn't have mains water taps. I loved going into the hen house. The hens excitedly followed me about, pecking softly at my little boots. But even then I noticed how desperate the girls were to get out to the green grass and weeds on the other side of the chicken wire fence. I remember one slipping past me out of the gate, and John effortlessly caught her and then handed her to me to stroke. Her bright fire-like eyes staring at me with her irradiating central pupils. Gathering freshly laid palm warm eggs was the main treat, each one a total perfect piece of work. The hens laid their eggs in deep old wooden fruit boxes lined with straw, and their shells were warm to the touch when we collected them, filling up the square cardboard egg trays. John and Gillian lived in a terraced house just down from the allotments, and they sold the eggs from there. Like their neighbours, their back garden had an old coal house along its back, well built and with a slate roof that John used as a tool shed. There was a white rabbit that used to graze the stamp-sized lawn. One day when we went round, I found that the rabbit had been joined by two beautiful silkies, like round little feather dusters. I adored them instantly. These hens were different to the layers. They were not only much smaller, but also seemed happy to be held. They didn't flap or cluck in alarm, and were more like teddy bears. The silkies roosted in with the rabbit within the low shelves and open drawers of John's tool cabinet, and got along very well together. The lawn was the key to their happy coexistence. I realised this quite quickly when trying to keep bantams in a garden without grass. Hens really need a lawn to peck on, otherwise they get very bored beaks and will peck whatever is available. John eventually gave up his allotment after several break-ins. During one, his hens were stolen. I remember asking John where the hens were. Looking down at me, he smiled and stretched out his arms and into the air and said, "They flew away!" For years we would walk to the top of the ranges and look down onto John's old plot. Although winter by winter its vividness had faded, I think his turquoise hen house is still there. Mercifully, so far, these plots haven't fallen to housing developers, but hundreds have in Hucknall alone, and gone are the characters who tended them. It is awful to see all these new build estates without access to spaces to grow food. Allotments, after all, need to be near homes if they are to be successfully adopted and used. Allotment plots hold an almost hobbit-like idealism for me, of having a plot of earth and just being content in cultivation and the rearing of animals. These days I enjoy allotment spotting from trains as they often back onto railway lines. This isn't brilliant news for those keeping hens though, because foxes use the tracks as highways. I particularly love that allotments aren't made to be rigidly neat like so many gardens are. Instead, there is a romantic ruggedness and great individuality to them. From the height of a train carriage, you get the best views of the lung-like hedges and the higgledy-piggledy fences dividing up the plots. Some are well-tended and prepped for the current growing season, while others are neglected, the rampage of brambles and nettles creating fortresses concealing tumbling greenhouses and collapsing sheds. Each is fascinatingly curious. Town allotments were the first setting of my life with chickens. The other would happen thanks to my grandparents' passion for holidaying, though, in the countryside. Visiting Derbyshire was our version of going to the seaside in the spring and summer holidays. We would spend days walking across the peaks, having picnics and paddling, especially in the bubbling streams.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.